Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. In his recent Space News interviews, comparative mythologist Ev Cochrane introduced his extraordinary decades-long research into ancient testimony of catastrophic celestial events witnessed on Earth. As Cochrane explained, in countless ancient cultures, the identities of familiar planets and myth, including Mars and Venus, cannot be explained in terms of anything seen in our world today. The planet Mars, a distant pinpoint of light to the unaided eye today, was globally identified as a warrior hero. The planet Venus, a bright pinpoint of light to modern skywatchers, was identified in various phases as a great comet, a goddess with flowing hair, a feathered serpent, and more. In this conclusion, Cochrane begins by explaining the painstaking methodology he and colleague David Talbott developed over their decades-long collaboration, which ultimately produced their reconstruction of recent planetary catastrophes witnessed on Earth.
I often compare the research of Dave and myself to that of James Watson and Francis Crick in reconstructing the precise helical structure of DNA. Initially, we were presented with just a giant jigsaw puzzle, as it were, with very few clues as to where the respective planets belong. In addition to the complex nature of the puzzle itself, this was an ever-evolving planetary configuration in which the planets change places and appearances over time. So consider, for example, the Eye of Heaven. Most scholars prior to us just simply identified the eye with the sun and never thought twice about it. Dave and I very early on discovered a link with the planet Venus. For example, ancient traditions around the globe identify Venus as an eye, and the same is true in certain ancient languages like the Maya. And yet at the same time, we found that the planet Mars was specifically identified as the pupil in the eye. And so as Dave and I thought about this situation, we quickly arrived at the idea that Mars must have stood in front of Venus, whereas a smaller body, it would appear as a dark dot or pupil inside the Venusian eye. Now, of course, in today's sky, Mars can't appear in front of Venus since it's an outer planet. But Mars is significantly smaller than Venus, so if it could stand in front of Venus, it would present this image that we had reconstructed of what the eye must have looked like. So this finding, this, let's say, hypothetical finding early on, it generated a host of other deductions. Mars must have formed the axle of the Venusian wheel. Mars was the child at Venus's breast, as depicted in numerous artworks of Inanna and Isis. We could supply hundreds and hundreds of other examples. In none of those examples, however, would the myth hold if Mars was behind Venus, like it is in today's sky, because, of course, you couldn't see it. You just see Venus. So it has to be in front of Venus. So that's just one case of countless dozens where slowly but surely we pieced together the evidence and arrived at the conclusion that during this particular phase in the evolution of the polar configuration, Mars must have been in front of Venus and thus closer to the Earth than the other planets. Looking back on our long relationship, I'm firmly convinced that whatever success we achieved, and I'm confident that our success was substantial and will stand the test of time, it required endless hours of research, detailed analysis, theoretical reasoning, followed by years of trying to model and visualize this polar configuration. And it would have been difficult for either of us to find success without the input and insights and encouragement of the other.
On this series, we have outlined the growing scientific evidence that the catastrophic events proposed by Cochrane and his colleagues did indeed happen. This includes the experimental analogs achieved by electrical discharge in the laboratory for countless planetary features. And of course, one of the greatest crises in space science today is the astounding failures of the standard theories of planet and star formation. As scientists discover increasing numbers of, quote, impossible exoplanetary systems, the question of our own solar system's origins and history grows increasingly muddled. We asked Ev how he might address scientists who have an unwavering faith in our solar system's 4.5 billion year history.
Well, first and foremost, astronomers must give up their collective fixation on the idea that planets have moved peacefully on their current orbits since the solar system was formed billions of years ago. That dogma has long since become a fundamental impediment to an accurate understanding of the solar system's recent history. Secondly, I would refer astronomers to Tony Peratt's groundbreaking researches into the celestial origins of the primary patterns of prehistoric rock art. As Tony documented in great detail using his vast knowledge of plasma under experimental conditions, the forms found in ancient rock art are virtually identical to certain forms generated in high energy discharge experiments. So, for example, the Ladder to Heaven, the Squatter Man, the Quincunx, you could cite again dozens and dozens of different structural forms or, quote, symbols. In the final analysis, Tony's findings demonstrate that incredibly powerful electromagnetic forces formerly played a significant role in the history of Earth's role in the solar system. And this is well within the last 10,000 years. And it's undeniable that such events were catastrophic in nature and provided much of the awe-inspiring imagery encoded in ancient myth and religion. And yet those electromagnetic plasma forces are nowhere seen in today's sky except in the relatively diminutive auroral images, you know, that we occasionally get that most people on Earth don't even see. Just within our lifetime, the astronomers' opinions of Mars and Venus have been forced to change just because of the findings that have been coming in from these various space probes. So when Dave and I originally were talking about massive volumes of rock falling down from Mars and hitting the Earth, the astronomers were unanimous in their decision or in their idea that meteorites or large rocks could never get off the surface of Mars. And yet now we know that dozens of Martian meteorites have indeed made their way to the Earth. And similarly, in our theory, where Mars is located during the polar configuration relatively close to the Earth, it stands to reason that it had a more temperate environment during that time, possibly had a massive atmosphere, possibly had plenty of water. This naturally leads to the conclusion that it could have had various life forms. And yet none of those things makes any sense whatsoever if Mars has always orbited countless millions of miles away from the sun, where it's freezing and water would never form and never flow. And it would be difficult to have an environment like that, an atmosphere. And so we believe that the water and the atmosphere, and if there were previous life forms, those were all extinguished within the last 10,000 years. Mars lost its atmosphere. It lost its water, if it indeed had it. It obviously lost a ton of its surface geology, as Wall and Dave have documented in great detail. And so what is true for Mars is also true for the planet Venus to some extent. Venus was a participant in these unbelievably spectacular exchanges of electromagnetic forces. And so you would certainly expect to see scarring on the Venusian planet, just like you see a ton of evidence of scarring on Mars. In our view, that didn't happen countless millions of years ago at the dawn of the solar system's history. It happened well within human memory. So we fully expect that when and if we're ever able to reliably date some of these geological events, it will stun the astronomers of how recent these events were.